In this module, we'll learn about relaxation processes, but before that, we'll also be talking about the nuclear spin, the energy levels of a spin half system, the Larmor frequency, the phenomenon of saturation, and different relaxation processes. So we already know that in the presence of an external magnetic field, a nuclear spin half system is split into two energy levels. The spin state alpha, in which the spin is aligned with the field, is lower in energy. Absorption of a photon of the requisite energy in the radio frequency region takes the spin to the upper level, at which point no further absorption of energy would take place. However, we are not dealing with a single proton. Rather, we are dealing with a sample which may contain a large number of protons. We thus have to take a macroscopic view, that is, we must consider a large ensemble of spins. For example, a sample size of 0.5 ml may contain as many as 10 raised power of 25 spins. We may expect all of these to align themselves with the magnetic field. However, there is the thermal energy that tends to disturb such an alignment. We already know that there is a Boltzmann distribution which governs the distribution of spins in the two energy levels. We have seen that if there is a single spin, then it can have either alpha or beta spin. Now, this single proton, if it is put in a magnetic field due to the Zeeman effect, it will align itself with the field. That means that the alpha spin will be there. But in a sample, we are dealing with a large number of spins. All of them are not aligned with the field. There will be some in the upper level, that is the beta level also, and this is due to the Boltzmann distribution, which depends upon the thermal energy. For example, in a magnetic field of 9.39 tesla, the Zeeman energy is given by delta E is equal to Gn beta n B0, where B0 is the magnitude of the magnetic field, and this is equal to gamma h cross into B0. Gamma, as you know, is the magnetogyric ratio, and if you insert all the values for a proton, you find that it turns out to be 2.65 into 10 raised power of 25 joules. And the thermal energy is KBT. Here KB is the Boltzmann constant. At room temperature, the thermal energy is equal to 4.14 into 10 raised power of minus 21 joule. Hence, that means that delta E by KBT, this ratio is equal to 6.4 into 10 raised power of 5. Since the thermal energy is 4 orders of magnitude higher than the Zeeman energy, there is only a very small preference for the lower energy state, and you will find that a large number of protons will be in the higher or the beta spin state. Ratio of populations is given by the Boltzmann distribution law. That means that n upper by n lower is equal to exponential minus delta E by KBT, and this turns out to be, because delta E by KT, as we've seen, is around 10 raised power of minus 4, you will find that you can use a simple Maclaurin expansion, and this is equal to 1 minus delta E by KBT, or this is equal to 0.999936, which is very small. And here we've used the expansion for exponential x, which is 1 minus exponential minus x is equal to 1 minus x plus x square by 2 factorial minus x cube by 3 factorial and so on. And since x is much smaller than 1, it is roughly of the order of 10 raised power of minus 5 or 10 raised power of minus 4. We can ignore all the subsequent terms and simply write it is equal to 1 minus x. What this means is that for every 10 raised power of 6 spins in the upper state, there will be 1.000064 spins in the lower energy state. This difference in populations is the reason we observe an NMR spectrum. Although this is very small, but if this difference was not there, you would not observe an NMR spectrum. But this difference, 64 in a population of 2 million nuclei, is extremely small and causes sensitivity problems in NMR spectroscopy. We will now explore the various relaxation mechanisms that maintain the population difference and allow us to observe a persistent NMR spectrum. We will first define what we mean by saturation in NMR spectroscopy. Now, suppose you have a system containing 2 into 10 raised power of 7 protons and a magnetic field of 9.39 3.9 Tesla is applied. At thermal equilibrium, there will be 64 protons extra in the lower state as compared to the upper state. Only that, only 64 more in the lower state as compared to the upper state. A radio frequency at the resonant frequency is now applied, so there will be absorption of radiation. The probability of the upward transition is the same as that of the downward transition, but because the population of the lower state is higher, initially there will be more upward transitions than downward transitions until the two populations become equal, something like an equilibrium is established, at which point no net absorption of radiation would take place and we say that saturation has occurred. Let the total number of spins be capital N, of which N U are in the upper level and N is small in the lower level. Then the total number of spins, since it is equal to N, will be equal to small n U plus small n L. And we also define the population difference by small n, and this is equal to n is equal to nl minus nu. When you add these two equations, you find that you can write down that n lower is equal to nl is equal to capital N plus small n by 2, and the upper level is slightly smaller, it is capital N minus small n divided by 2. The rate of change of the population of the lower state is given by dnl by dt as usual, and this is equal to n upper into probability of u to l, probability of a transition from the upper state to the lower state, because this is populating the lower state, minus the population of the lower state into the probability of a transition from the lower to the upper state, denoted by capital L p l u to u, where p l arrow u and p u arrow l refer to the probabilities of the upward and downward transitions respectively. The probability of the upward transition is equal to that of the downward transition, because both are proportional to the Einstein transition probabilities. As you already know, p l to u is equal to b l u into rho, and rho at a particular frequency nu. B l u, as you know, is the Einstein transition probability, and rho nu is the radiation density, and because both of them are equal, because the dipole moment operator in BLU is Hermitian, we may therefore write P U to L is equal to P L to U, and both of them we can replace by another symbol capital P. Therefore, combining equations 1, 3 and 4, we may now write dNL by dt, and NL, as you already know, is capital N plus small n by 2, so we can write it as half d n plus n by dt, and this is equal to half d small n by dt, because capital N is the total number of spins, which is a constant, and this n is equal to nu minus nl into p, and or we can write it down as small n minus n into p. Equation 5 may be integrated with respect to the time to give dnl by dt is equal to minus 2np, or n is equal to n within bracket 0 exponential minus 2 pt, and n0 is the population difference at time 0, that is before the application of the radio frequency. So the rate of absorption of energy is simply given by dE by dt is equal to p into nl minus nu into delta E, or this is equal to p small n into delta E, or this is equal to p n0 exponential minus 2 pt delta E. This is an exponentially decaying function because of that exponential term, whose rate of decay increases with increase in the transition probability. And in figure, we have shown the exponential decay of the rate of energy absorption. So you can see exponential decay ultimately falls off to almost zero. At equilibrium then, the number of spins going from the upper level to the lower level, and those coming from the lower level to the upper level, it is equal, or nu into pu to l is equal to nl pl to u, and this is equal to nu is equal to nl. This is what it implies, because pu to l is equal to pl to u, and both of them are equal to p, and because the two transition probabilities are equal. This is called saturation, when the net rate of absorption of energy from the radiation becomes zero. However, there are certain processes called relaxation processes that continue to maintain a population difference, and hence a persistent NMR spectrum is observed. If these processes were not there, soon there would be no absorption of radiation, because as you've seen, the population of the upper and lower levels becomes equal, and since the probability of transition from upper to lower level or lower to upper is the same, there would be no net absorption, and very soon the NMR spectrum would not be visible. But this is not so, and that is because of relaxation. Now, what is relaxation? As we've seen, absorption of radiation causes the spins in the lower energy state to flip to the upper energy state until the populations of the two states become equal. Disturbs the equilibrium population. Relaxation is the process by which the spins return to equilibrium. That is the state in which the populations are those determined by the Boltzmann distribution law, because that has to be maintained. Also, in an NMR experiment, initially both alpha and beta spins have equal population, because if there is no magnetic field, they will have equal population because they have the same energy, they are degenerate, and in the absence of an external magnetic field. When a magnetic field is applied, the two states are no longer degenerate and the Boltzmann distribution takes over. This does not happen immediately, but depends upon something called the relaxation time. The rate of spontaneous emission depends on the frequency of the radiation, and since this is small in the radio frequency region, spontaneous emission is relatively slow in this region. There are essentially two relaxation processes that are important in NMR spectroscopy, and these are called spin lattice relaxation and spin-spin relaxation, and we'll first describe the spin lattice relaxation. If the state of the system is not an equilibrium state, then some spins from the state which has a population in excess of the equilibrium value determined by the Boltzmann distribution law must move to the other state. Such transitions can be conveniently described in terms of chemical kinetics rate constants. Let the rates of the transitions from the upper state to the lower state and vice versa be denoted by P with a downward arrow and P with an upward arrow respectively. These are first order processes and the rates are directly proportional to the populations of the respective levels. Then the differential rate of change of the population of the lower level is given by dNL by dt is equal to half dN by dt, as we had earlier said, but this time it is equal to nu into p downward minus nL into p upward. Note that these are radiationless processes and hence p downward is not necessarily equal to p upwards, which was there in that case, because there we were dealing with the transition dipole moment which was equal in both the cases. In fact, we should show that it is not equal. At equilibrium, the rate of change of the population is 0, and hence dNL by dt is equal to 0 is equal to n upper 0 initial population of the upper level p downward minus nL 0 the initial population of the lower level p upward, and this should be equal to 0, and that means p upward by p downward ratio is equal to n upper 0 by nL 0 is equal to exponential minus h nu 0 by 2 kBt divided by exponential minus h naught nu by 2 kBt, and this is equal to exponential h naught 0 by kBt. Here nL 0 and nu 0 are the equilibrium populations predicted by the Boltzmann distribution law. Since this predicts a higher population for the lower level, it follows that the rate of the downward transition is higher, as it should be to attain equilibrium. The extent to which the rates are different depends on the resonance frequency. This kind of relaxation is called spin lattice relaxation. Early NMR experiments used to be carried out in solid lattices, and the name continues for historical reasons. That is why it is called lattice. By lattice we mean the surroundings which are in a state of constant motion and cause fluctuating magnetic fields. A component of the translational or rotational motion of these spins may match the Larmor frequency of the proton and cause a transition between the two spin states the probability of a downward transition of the spin is higher since it involves an upward transition in the lattice in order to conserve the total energy. So if it is a downward transition in the spins that you are looking at, then for the lattice it is an upward transition, because you have to conserve energy. Whatever is gained from the lattice is put in the spin. The populations of the energy levels of the lattice are also governed by the Boltzmann distribution law. Since the lower energy levels are more highly populated, an upward transition in the lattice is more likely. Correspondingly, the downward transition in the spin system is more likely, and hence equilibrium is re-established. Now coming back to equation 9 and inserting equations 1 and 2, we obtain dNL by dt is equal to again half dN by dt, and this is equal to capital N minus N by 2, where we put in the values of the N upper and N lower, P downward transition minus N plus N small n by 2 into P upward is equal to half dN t. This implies that half dN by dt is equal to N by 2, P downward minus P upward minus small n by 2, P downward plus P upward, and this is equal to half P downward plus P upward into capital N P downward minus P upward divided by P downward plus P upward minus N, and therefore dN by dt is equal to P downward plus P upward into N P downward minus P upward divided by P downward plus P upward minus N, and this equation can be rewritten as dN by dt small n is equal to 1 by T1 N0 minus N, and here T1 is equal to 1 by P downward plus P upward, and this is called the spin lattice relaxation time. It is the inverse of the sum of two first order rate constants and hence has the dimension of time. It is also called longitudinal relaxation time because this small population difference between the lower and upper states induces a net magnetization parallel to the field direction. Combining equations 5 and 13 for the case when the radiation is on and spin lattice relaxation is also occurring. Now, this was first we had talked about just what happens when the radiation is on, and now we were talking about relaxation, but at a time both processes are occurring. So we will add the two processes and we will write dN by dt is equal to 1 by T1 N0 minus N as we had just obtained minus 2 P N. At equilibrium the rate of change of population, that is dN by dt, is 0. Hence 1 by T1 N0 minus N is equal to 2 P N, and this means that N is equal to N0 divided by 1 plus 2 P T1. The rate of absorption of energy from the radiation is now given by dE by dt is equal to N P delta E is equal to N0 P delta E by 1 plus 2 P T1. If the spin lattice relaxation time is large, that is the rate constants of spin lattice relaxation are small and consequently relaxation is inefficient, that is 2pt1 is much greater than 1, then dE by dt will be equal to N0 by P delta E divided by 2pt1, where we ignored the other term, and this simplifies to N0 delta E by 2t1, and saturation will set in. But if T1 is small, that is relaxation is more efficient, dE by dt will be large and a persistent NMR spectrum will be observed. Now we will talk about the width of spectral lines, because besides spin lattice relaxation, there is also another kind of relaxation which is called the spin-spin relaxation, and this is caused by the interaction between adjacent spins. One spin goes up in energy while the other goes down due to this energy exchange. Now because of this, there is no net change in the populations of the two levels, but there is an uncertainty in the energies of the spins, and this goes on to broaden the spectral lines. This is also called transverse relaxation as opposed to longitudinal for the first case, and this is characterized by a spin-spin relaxation time, and this is given the symbol T2. In liquids, the spin lattice relaxation time T1 is of the order of 1.6 second, but is less efficient, that is T1 is longer in solids because of restricted motion in solids. The spin-spin relaxation time is also of the order of 2 seconds in liquids, but is smaller in solids, in which it is more effective because of the closer proximity of the spins. Since it involves exchange of energy between two spins, they are closer in solids and so it is more efficient. That means the spin relaxation time is shorter in solids. The lifetime of the upper state, that is the time taken for its population to drop to 1 by E, that is around 63%, is of its original value is given by 1 by T is equal to 1 by T1 plus 1 by T2. The shapes of the spectral lines are roughly Lorentzian because they are dictated by the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, and the width of the line will be given by T into delta E, and this is approximately equal to H cross according to the uncertainty principle, or T into delta nu is equal to 1 by 2 pi. The width of the spectral line at half maximum is given by delta nu half is equal to 1 by pi T, since the spectral line appears at nu naught plus delta nu. For a spin having a lifetime of 1.6 second, this translates to about a width of 0.2 hertz. Now, in summary, the nuclear magnetic resonance is concerned with spins of nuclei. Only spins with spin quantum numbers not equal to 0 show NMR spectra. Since the energy levels are closely spaced, the difference in the populations of the two levels in a spin half state is very small and soon saturation sets in. There are two kinds of relaxation processes that restore the Boltzmann distribution. One is the spin lattice and the other is the spin-spin relaxation. The former involves exchange of energy with the surroundings, while the latter involves exchange of energy between neighboring spins.